Now we continue with intervention. Intervention, by the word intervention, we think of the word intervened, which means there is already something going on and you or your client would like to join that something that is going on. So what this means is there is already an ongoing case and you, on behalf of your client, would like to enter the picture. This is what we know as intervention. A remedy in which a third party who is not originally impleaded in the pleadings becomes a litigant to enable him or her to protect or preserve his right or interest which may be affected by such proceedings. Intervention is not a matter of right. It is a matter of discretion upon the judge. So the appropriate motion has to be filed. And there are requisites for intervention. This was asked in the bar exam of 2000. There are requisites that are mentioned in Section 1. And if you study the requirements under Section 1, the requisites are as follows. Number 1, a person has a legal interest in the subject matter of litigation. Number 2, or he has a legal interest in the success of any of the parties. 3, or he has an interest against both parties. Or, number 4, he is so situated as to be adversely affected by a distribution or disposition of property in the custody of the court or an officer thereof. Okay? So, the court is required to balance between certain considerations such as, number 1, whether or not the intervention will unduly delay or prejudice the adjudication of the rights of the original parties, and number 2, whether or not the intervener's rights may be fully protected in a separate proceeding. Now, key dito is the legal interest of the party who wants to intervene. And what is the meaning of legal interest? It means present interest, actual, material, direct, and immediate, not merely contingent or expectant. It's necessary that the intervener or prospective intervener will either gain or lose by the direct legal operation of the judgment. And so the procedure is outlined in Rule 19. And let us see, no? Section 1. Actually, in Rule 19, wala siyang change. Walang substantial change. Okay, Section 1. Who may intervene? A person who has a legal interest in the matter in litigation or in the success of either of the parties, or an interest against both, or is so situated as to be adversely affected by a distribution or other disposition of property in the custody of the court or an officer thereof, he may, with leave of court, be allowed to intervene in the action. And the court shall consider whether or not the intervention will unduly delay or prejudice the adjudication of the rights of the original parties, and whether or not the intervener's rights may be fully protected in a separate proceeding. So there is a time for filing a motion to intervene, and that's in Section 2. Okay? The motion to intervene may be filed at any time before rendition of judgment by the trial court. So kahit nakapag-present na ng ebidensya, yung mga parties, kahit yung defendant na yung nag-present ng evidence, tapos na yung plaintiff, as long as there is no judgment yet rendered by the trial court, then a party can still intervene. Okay, so nakalagay dito, judgment of the trial court. That means, if it is on appeal, hindi na pwede. Even if there is still a judgment that is a subject modification on appeal, hindi na pwede. Dapat, before judgment of the trial court. Okay, and a copy of the pleading in intervention shall be attached to the motion and served on the original party. So, paano to? Yung gustong mag-intervene, magpa-file ng motion to intervene, isocite niya yung requisites, yung presence ng requisites sa kanyang situation, and attach the pleading in intervention. So, ano naman yung pleading in intervention? Well, the answer is, it depends in what capacity he wants to intervene. So, we find that in Section 3. The intervener shall file a complaint in intervention if he or she asserts a claim against either or all of the original parties. So, kapag against the plaintiff siya or and against the defendant or against all of them, he will file a complaint in intervention. Okay, next, He may file an answer in intervention if he or she unites with a defending party in resisting a claim against the latter. All right, so let us say that a party has filed a complaint in intervention. What's the next step of the other party against whom the complaint in intervention was filed? And that's in Section 4. The answer to the complaint in intervention shall be filed within 15 calendar days from notice of the order admitting the same, unless a different period is fixed by the court. So, yun lang ang mga rules ng intervention. Ang pinakamahalaga dito, natatandaan ninyo, is yung present interest ng prospective intervenor. And then the next rule is Rule 20. This is calendar of cases. Walang change. Ang sinasabi lang dito, it is the clerk of court who will keep a calendar of cases for pre-trial, trial, and those whose trials were adjourned or postponed, and those with motions to set for a hearing. Pag nilala mo yung rule on motions in the Rule 15, konti na lang ang mga motions that are set for a hearing, and they are set upon discretion of the court. Okay? And then, preference shall be given to habeas corpus cases, election cases, special civil actions, and those so required by law because of the nature of these cases. Now, Section 2, assignment of cases. The assignment of cases to the different branches of a court shall be done exclusively by raffle. The assignment shall be done in open session, of which adequate notice shall be given to afford interested parties the opportunity to be present. There is actually a date for a schedule of raffle of cases, and the parties can go there and watch how the cases are raffled to the branches. Okay? And then we also have Rule 21 on subpoena. Okay? Ang subpoena, ito ay tinatawag na compulsory process. This is a way by which the court directs parties either to appear before the court and testify, ang tawag doon, subpoena ad testificandum, or the court directs the parties to produce a document, ang tawag doon, subpoena duces tecum. So let's see, no? Section 1, subpoena is a process directed to a person requiring him or her to attend and to testify at the hearing or trial of an action or at any investigation conducted by competent authority or for the taking of his or her deposition. So, tatlo to. Yung first one is when there is a trial. Yung second is when there is an investigation conducted by a competent authority such as the investigating prosecutor in a criminal case. And the third is for the taking of his or her deposition, which means there may already be a pending case or they may not. Later, we will take up the meaning of deposition. And then, Section 1 also says, the subpoena may require him or her to bring any books, documents, or other things under his or her control, in which case it is called a subpoena duces tecum. Now, who is the one who issues the subpoena? And that we can find in Section 2. We have four persons who may issue. Letter A, the court before whom the witness is required to attend. Letter B, the court for the place where the deposition is to be taken. Okay, so yung deposition is the taking of the testimony of a person before an entity which is not the same as the court in which the case is pending. So pwedeng court. Okay, court in another place. Let's say the hearing, the trial is taking place in the RTC of Quezon City and the witness is in Kamalanyugan, Cagayan. Okay, the deposition can be taken there if the witness cannot come to Quezon City for the testimony. And it is that court there that can issue the subpoena for purposes of deposition taking. Now, letter C, the officer or body authorized by law to do so in connection with investigations conducted by said officer or body. So we have the investigating prosecutor, the prosecutor's office. And then we also have a subpoena that can be issued by the office of the ombudsman. And then letter D, any justice of the Supreme Court or Court of Appeals in any case or investigation pending within the Philippines. And it further says, when an application for a subpoena to a prisoner is made, the judge or officer shall examine and study carefully such application to determine whether the same is made for a valid purpose. Hindi ibig sabihin na porke nag-file ng request for subpoena, igagrant na yun agad ng court. Siyempre, kasi that's a dangerous situation when a prisoner will be required to go to court for purposes of testifying. Hindi lang yun, maraming mga security measures ang kailangan. Okay, and then last paragraph, no prisoner sentenced to death, reclusion perpetua, or life imprisonment who is confined in any penal institution shall be brought outside the penal institution for appearance or attendance in any court unless authorized by the Supreme Court. Okay, very, very important. Number three, form and contents. Ito, hindi nyo na talaga masyadong kailangan itong i-memorize. Alamin nyo lang, of course, it's in writing. It shall state the court, the title of the action, investigation, directed to the person whose attendance is required. Pero kung sa pinadusas tecum, it will contain a reasonable description of the books, documents, and things demanded, which must appear to the court prima facie relevant. What's the effect if a subpoena was issued by a court and the person to whom it is addressed would not think that there is a justifiable reason for the subpoena? Ito, nasa section 4 yan. The court may quash the subpoena. So, dapat yung taong nagku-question nung subpoena will file a motion to quash. So, here, the court may quash a subpoena duces tecum upon motion promptly made. And in any event, at or before the time specified therein, if it is unreasonable and oppressive, or the relevancy of the books, documents, or things does not appear, or if the person in whose behalf the subpoena is issued fails to advance the reasonable cause of the production thereof. So, tatlong dahilan. Ang dapat i-raise sa motion to quash the subpoena. First, it must be shown that it's unreasonable and oppressive. Second, that it is irrelevant. And third, hindi binigyan ng pamasahe, hindi binigyan ng expenses. So not just for pamasahe, but also for production. So, the person who is requesting the subpoena did not advance the reasonable cost of production. Kung ad testificandum naman, dito yung tinutukoy ko na hindi binigyan ng pamasahe, kasi here, motion to quash a subpoena ad testificandum. The ground is the witness is not bound thereby, and it may be quashed on the ground that the witness's fees and kilometrage allowed by the rules were not tendered when the subpoena was served. Importante to, lalo na kung ang witness nasa malayong lugar at mahalang pamasahe. Kaya ang remedy dyan, imbis na subpoena at testificandum, dapat subpoena for deposition. So we go to section 5. Subpoena for deposition. Proof of service of a notice to take a deposition, this is under Rule 23, shall constitute sufficient authorization for the issuance of subpoenas for the persons named in said notice by the clerk of the court of the place in which the deposition is to be taken. The clerk shall not, however, issue a subpoena duces tecum to any person without an order from the court. Okay, so again, it is the clerk of court who shall issue that. And section 6, service. Service shall be made in the same manner as personal or substituted service. The original shall be exhibited, a copy delivered, and it must allow sufficient time to prepare and for the person to travel to the place of attendance. And then yung cost for court attendance, production of documents, shall be tendered or charged accordingly. Okay, so hindi ito expense ng person who is being subpoenaed. Dapat yung party who is interested in the production of those documents or in the prestation of that person in court will be the one to pay for the expenses. Section 7. A personal appearance in court. A person present in court before a judicial officer may be required to testify as if he or she were in attendance upon a subpoena issued by such court or officer. What does this mean? Let's say, nandun yung police, part siya ng case, pero he is there in court for another case, and nandun na siya. The court may require him to testify as if he had been subpoenaed. And then section 8, compelling attendance. In case of failure of a witness to attend, the court or judge issuing the subpoena upon proof of service and failure of the witness may issue a warrant to the sheriff to arrest the witness and bring him or her before the court or officer where his attendance is required. And the cost of such warrant and seizure shall be paid by the witness if the court issuing it shall determine that his failure to answer the subpoena was willful and without just excuse. So, binigyan siya ng pamasahe, binigyan sa kanya yung cost of production of whatever document is being required, and still hindi siya nag-attend. The court can issue a warrant directing the arrest of that person. So, ibig sabihin, pwede ka bang mag-refuse to obey a subpoena? The answer is technically hindi if all the requisites are present. And then section 9, may penalty pa, no? Failure by a person without adequate cause to obey a subpoena that is duly served upon him shall be deemed a contempt of the court from which the subpoena is issued. If the subpoena was not issued by a court, the disobedience shall be punished in accordance with the applicable law or rule. Okay, so again, hindi pwedeng i-refuse ang subpoena. Okay, and then section 10, exceptions. This rule shall not apply to a witness who resides more than 100 kilometers from his or her residence to the place where he is to testify by the ordinary course of travel or to a detention prisoner if no permission of the court in which his or her case is pending was obtained. So ang remedy dito, kung hindi talaga pwede kasi malayo, you go for deposition. Okay, so let's go to Rule 22, Computation of Time. This is familiar to you. This is what you study in the preliminary title of Persons and Family Relations. No? So in Section 1, how to compute time. In computing any period of time prescribed or allowed by the rules or by order of the court or any applicable statute, the day and of the day of the acts or event from which the designated period of time begins to run is to be excluded, and the date of performance included. So ito yung rule na the first day shall be excluded and the last day shall be included. So kung 15 days ngayon natanggap, 15 days yung period, bukas mag-umpisa yung counting ng first day. Okay? And then the second sentence, if the last day of the period falls on a Saturday, Sunday, or legal holiday in the place where the court sits, the time shall not run until the next working day. Of course, that is self-explanatory. And then section 2, effect of interruption. Should an act be done which effectively interrupts the running of the period, the allowable period after such interruption shall start to run on the day after notice of the cessation of the cause thereof. The day of the act that caused the interruption shall be excluded in the computation of the period. Okay? So you know that already. This ends our video for Rule 19, 20, 21, and 22. The next video will be about modes of discovery.